Oh, Raku. Raku, I never quite understood you, to be honest. Oh, Raku.
Ah, where's the dream again?
The goggles.
Oh, God, it seems dangerous. Raku. It's so hot.
It's glowing.
Careful.
Raku!
It must be Raku week, because the dream's returned. Welcome to the Great Pottery Throwdown. Rose, the Raku dreams come back. Do you want to hear all about it?
No, thanks. Oh.
Last time, the potter slaved over slabs.
The good bash is very good for the spirit.
To produce twin Staffordshire flatbacks.
I don't understand what Staffordshire flatbacks are.
Why?
And while Donna's pristine pair secured Potter of the Week, Shani's slabs buckled under the pressure.
I got a Matthew crack.
And she became the latest potter to leave the competition. This time, it's back to nature. With a farmyard animal sculpting challenge. There's a popular bird in the spot test.
I've done a robin.
Anyone else doing a robin?
Me.
Me.
Yeah.
And the potters take on an ancient art.
Raku man.
But who will triumph? Woo! And whose hopes of staying will go up in flames?
Uh-oh. Uh-oh.
Remaining potters are back for the week they've all been looking forward to and dreading in equal measure.
Raku week, innit?
Fire, fun and panic.
Fire. Fire and danger. It's just going to be great, innit?
It should be fun. There's a lot of risk involved. There's a lot of opportunities for things to pop off or crack or snap off.
It's obviously crossed my mind that it might explode. But yeah, I think it's going to be so exciting.
Totally terrified, but... you know what? We're going to give it a go.
Welcome back, potters, to the pottery and to Raku Week. The judges would like you to make an animal bust. The animals should be an animal found around the farm and should be a realistic interpretation. Keith, any advice for our farmers? I mean potters.
We want you to slab make your farmyard animals. We're really looking for realism here. Think about how you're going to create those textures of wool, fur and feathers.
Great. You have been given 5 hours to make and refine your animal busts, and your time starts now!
Raku week starting. Lovely. Bring it on.
Nervously excited, yes.
Sculpting, I'm looking forward to it. I want to make it as real as it can be.
So, Rich.
Yes.
Raku week.
Yes. I mean, what's not to love about Raku? Fire, smoke, spontaneous result.
And the unpredictability.
Definitely.
So, we've asked them to make an animal that you would find on a farm. We're looking for that realism in them. If they choose a ram or a cow, it's those different appendages that are quite fragile.
They need to just make sure they're really well joined, because that's going to be a potential weak spot when it comes to the rigours of the Raku firing process.
Yeah, it's such a violent process.
Definitely.
It's going to be really interesting how they incorporate different textures within this Raku process.
Yeah. They just need to have a really careful, measured approach to the whole of this process. It's a trial by fire, quite literally.
Hello, lovey.
Hello.
Hi, Sophie.
Hello.
So, tell us about your design.
So, I'm doing a donkey.
Is that you on the donkey?
Yeah, that's me on a donkey. So we always used to go down to like Weston at summer and always have the donkey rides, which I always loved. And then that's my dad's donkey when he grew up. He had a little donkey in the field next to his house.
And does your donkey have a name?
Anita. So that was the name of my dad.
Anita. Love
my
it.
Dad's donkey, so yeah.
Brilliant.
Sophie plans to give Anita depth using underglazes, crackle glaze and oxides, but the Raku firing will be a step into the unknown for her.
A bit nervous for today. I think all new things I've never done before.
You've never done any Raku before at all?
No, never done Raku.
Well, that's great because you might get beginner's luck.
Hopefully.
All of the potters are using formers.
Underneath is a ball of wrapped up newspaper.
To provide temporary support until the clay is firm enough to maintain its own form.
When it comes to getting it out, that's when the stress will kick in.
And while most have opted for something fairly basic...
There's no detail, it's just a lump on a stick.
Others have taken a more sophisticated approach.
Dave, this is like the most amazing piece of carpentry.
The former actually takes apart into 5 bits. So I can remove it a bit at a time without having to alter the shape, and that's where cracks will occur.
While Dave's designed a former that's easy to extract...
It'll be good.
Stephen's will require some surgery.
Because I'm building it on top of a mould, I'm going to be cutting it off at the end, so I'm going to be cutting it in two and then reconnecting it.
I'm making a cow.
It's based off of a pet cow that my father-in-law used to have. It's called Demi Moore. Farmyard classic, you know.
Stephen will portray Demi with her tongue up her nose. He'll achieve her monochrome colouring by contrasting matte black with shiny white crackle glaze. But before that, she must go under the knife.
Just keep an eye when you split the whole thing in half.
Because that joint, that's going to be quite fragile.
Yeah.
Straight up. Perfect, thank you.
But Stephen's not the only one taking a risk with his former.
I want to start moulding it from the inside, so I've decided to take the former out pretty early. I'm making a barn out. I think they look kind of cool, you know? A little mysterious, a little inquisitive, so I thought with a posture change, with a tilted head, that would add a bit of character.
Along with its characteristic head tilt, heart-shaped face and piercing black eyes, Daniel will use underglazes and oxides to highlight the subtle beauty of this enigmatic creature.
I love owls.
Yeah. They're a little mysterious. There's been a mystique there.
People have described me as owl-like.
I'm just curious because they're quite sleek, quite plain, quite pared back. How will that work with the Raku process?
Yeah, so I'm hoping to add some texture with these sprig molds.
Okay.
What I'm going to do is essentially kind of press into it from the inside.
So that's going to be tricky timing, isn't it? Because if it's too dry, it'll just crack.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, thanks, Daniel.
Cheers. Thank you.
But Daniel's barn owl won't be flying solo in the pottery today.
I'm doing a red kite. You know, they're really useful around the farm. They eat rodents. They're an important part of our ecosystem. Hi. Yeah, I'm a red kite. I rock.
Katie's keeping things simple when it comes to the sculpting side of the challenge, relying instead on her decorating ability and the effects of the Raku to bring out the beauty in her favourite bird of prey's distinctive plumage.
I am worried. Because it's quite a simplistic form, it's really important that it is as realistic as I can get it. It needs that character to really bring it to life.
And Katie isn't the only one feeling the pressure.
I've only ever done human sculpting, and that's not gone too well for me. So I'm definitely out of my comfort zone here. I'm doing a fox. Most of the childhood stories that I really enjoyed have elements of, like, a fox. Even the movie Fantastic Mr. Fox, I remember watching and just being like, it was really, really great.
Coupled with her happy memories, Princess is drawn to the geometric form and lustrous coat of the fox. And she's taken a unique approach to the build.
The bust is on like a cylinder. So there's this.
Oh, wow.
I'll be cutting down a bit. And Fantastic. So it's going to sit on the neck.
Okay.
So I think the only thing I need to make sure of, it has to be nicely sealed so that it doesn't create a weak point and then cracks. Hopefully it all goes well.
Like sculpting the skeleton, first of all. The bone structure is what makes it look realistic.
Keith and Rich will be looking for busts that are anatomically correct and intricately detailed.
The muscles are quite tight in the cow's head, so I'm going to try and really accentuate those areas.
So eyes now, making sure that they don't look weird.
Done quite a few sketches trying to get the eyes right, and they've got distinctive bright orangey green eyes and these huge big kind of oblong black pupils, so I want to make sure I get those in because I think that they're really distinctive on the goat.
As well as its unique eyes, Donna's largely monochrome billy goat will be highly textured, sport a bushy beard and a fine set of curly horns.
What's your plan for all these textures? Because there's lovely kind of horns additions and hair.
I do want to get quite a bit of white in the crackle glaze because I want to get lots of crackle through it. And then the rest of it, I'm going to use wax resist to try and get the dark carbonisation. Okay. And then on the horns, I want to try and get a bronze kind of effect on that.
Okay.
That is the plan. I'm hoping that it works.
But Donna's isn't the only goat in the pottery.
It's quite an exciting shape to make. It's got the horns, the ears, the forehead. You know, there'll be a point when it'll look goaty and it stops looking like a giraffe, hopefully.
Dan's also hoping to achieve a metallic effect with oxides, which he will apply to his goat's face as well as its horns in a bid to outshine two times Potter of the Week, Donna.
Who is the goat, do you think?
It's definitely Donna.
Greatest of all time.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, absolutely.
I love that Dan was expecting you to go, oh, no, no, it's yeah, not Dan. And she's like, yeah, greatest of all time. Yes, I bloody well am. About time someone noticed.
OK, I can now add some more donkey features.
Any attachments the potters add?
So I've got ears, and then I've got a tongue that's coming out of the mouth into the nose.
Will be particularly vulnerable when it comes to the brutal raku firing.
Just gonna make sure I really blend. Loads of slip and scoring really blend.
I'd worry about the horns. Gonna make sure that I join them so well.
But when it comes to his choice of farmyard creature, Dave is throwing caution to the wind.
So I've just put the snood on. They're really odd animals. Turkeys, all the strange appendages on them. It takes risk to a whole new level. And the contrasting colours, I'm hoping, will really pop. If it works, it would be brilliant.
Having narrowly missed out on Potter of the Week in previous weeks, Dave is pulling out all the stops with an ambitious, intricate and colourful design. As well as the turkey snood, caruncles and wattle, he'll add each feather individually.
Are you putting texture on this bit for the feathers?
Yeah, sort of little arcs of clay and starting at the back and working down.
Oh, that's a lot of work.
Yeah, but if that oxide works with it, it's going to look stunning.
It could look great,
yeah.
Couldn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah.
And Dave, how are you enjoying this whole experience?
Well, it's a bit like being in prison.
Oh, right.
But it's a prison with a very well-developed craft rehabilitation course.
Because as people don't realise, there is barbed wire all the way round Gladstone Museum.
That's because I tried to escape last year.
Potters, you're halfway through. Stephen, you're halfway moo. And Daniel, you're halfway to it, to woo!
Texture time. My detail is going to be in the kind of fur.
Lots and lots and lots of feathers. A rather repetitive task.
To achieve the realistic fur, feathers or hair demanded by Keith and Rich.
Donkeys are quite fluffy, I suppose. So I'm just trying to, like, really define that.
The potters must consider every mark they make and how they can make the most of it during the raku firing.
Some of these areas, I haven't tried to score into them too much because I want it all to crack when I add the white crackle glaze.
I'm doing feather textures. It's going to be my secret weapon because those little ridges are going to really look lovely.
But whilst Katie's plan is coming together, Daniel's sprig moulds are causing him problems.
I am a bit worried about the feather texture I've tried to add. It's kind of making the clay start to crack as it dries out a bit. So I might just smooth over and sort of see what I can do later.
Every time I look at it, I need to alter something. So I'm just going to concentrate on getting a hairy neck, because obviously, you know, you're not an alpaca unless you've got a hairy neck.
Jan will use red iron oxide to capture the rich tones of her alpaca's coat, which she's fashioning with the help of a kitchen cupboard staple.
Have you done all the tinfoil?
Not all of it.
Can I do some?
Go on, yeah. Any way you like, stick it in.
Ooh, he's a bit soft, isn't he?
He's very soft, yeah. I need him to harden up.
Yeah, buck up, sir. Buck up, life's tough, but you've got to deal with it. Potters, you've 1 hour left, 1 hour left.
With the clock ticking, it's the moment of truth.
I'm going to start trying to peel out the former.
The potters must treat their busts with the utmost care.
I just need to get this base out to begin with. Ooh, ooh, ooh.
The more they manipulate the clay...
The paper's sort of stuck and it's shrunk in there.
..the greater the chance of cracks.
Oh, this is really stuck in there.
Oh, my God, I don't want to have to cut it open.
I've had to cut it to take it off the former. It's quite sturdy, so hopefully it's OK.
But for Stephen and Dan, Radical surgery was always part of the plan.
So I'm going all the way down the central line.
It's got a former inside, so I need to chop the whole thing open to get that out.
I wouldn't do that. Mine isn't getting cut in half. Nobody would be that foolhardy.
Nobody would be that foolhardy. May I introduce you to Dan?
I know. Oh, it's out! And it's held its shape. Amazing!
Oh, yes. This man is an engineering genius.
Good.
Oh, my God, what if there are small chocolate goats inside there? Is that how goats are made?
This is like a Damien Hirst artwork.
Wicked. Yeah, perfect. Thank you so much.
That's a pleasure.
Not only will any joins have to survive a bisque firing, they also face the violent and unforgiving Raku process.
I am a bit worried that the structural integrity is starting to come apart.
And Daniel's come up with a plan to strengthen his owl.
I figured it'd be better to add new wings. It should help reinforce it a little bit. Hopefully it stays on and firing.
Potters, you've half an hour left. Half an hour left.
Doing the feathers is going to kill me, I think. Next time I'm just going to do a Raku worm. Roll it out, stick it in the kiln. Job's a good one.
It'll turn into fur in a minute, because they have a really big puffy part, and I really want that to sort of stand out.
Princess has chosen to work on the two pieces completely in isolation.
Yeah.
You know, will it feel like a tube and a head?
Yeah.
Or will it feel like that kind of flowing fur of a fox?
It seems fairly firm on, so I'm just going over any joins and making sure that they're smoothed in.
I'd be concerned about Daniel's dowel.
He decided to emboss sheets of clay and then stick on whole sheets.
Okay.
I'm a bit concerned that if those become delaminated, he could lose a whole section.
We've got a recovering Demi on the table. And yeah, she's nearly there.
Stephen. He's cut the whole thing in half. And it wants to be really well bonded, because if it isn't, we all know joins can equal cracks.
What noise does a cow make? That's quite good. 10 minutes left, Potters, 10 minutes left.
But I'm just gonna concentrate on getting a hairy neck.
Everything is in the fur to give it more depth.
Now I'm worrying I've made it too simplistic, you know. There's always scope for torturing yourself.
I think he looks quite regal. I've called him Gary. I might need to change his name, because the Gary that he's named after is not regal.
Potters, a reminder that your animal busts should be in the drying room.
Oh, God, I hope it fires all right.
The thing about when you hand build is you never know when it ends. It looks OK, and then you look back at it and you find one more thing to do.
Well, I'm not rushing.
Galloping into the drying room.
We'll see if the form holds together.
Well done, wasn't that fun?
Yes.
I was enjoying that. The turkey came together fine. Bring on the Raku.
Once dried, Rose will bisque fire the animal busts in readiness for the decoration and then the all-important Raku firing.
I'm confident that I won't get a crack in the middle.
I am maybe a bit worried about the wings, like, flapping off, but, yeah, I think it should be OK.
No wheels.
It's not throwing, thank God for that.
The Potters are back to face their second challenge. And as usual, they have no idea what it's going to be.
Welcome back, Potters. Your second challenge this week is a mark-making and design challenge. And we have a very special guest judge. Please give a warm pottery welcome to Jackie Atkin. Hello. Hello. Hello, Jackie. Welcome. Lovely to have you here.
Thank you for having me.
Jackie has been making her mark on the pottery world for over 20 years, specialising in bold, colourful ceramics which combine botanical and bird imagery. Her mastery of mark making creates elaborate textured surfaces, and Jackie's pieces have exhibited in galleries across the UK.
Beautiful. Are you nervous yet?
Yeah, very nervous.
You should be.
Okay, you'll all have one of these. What I'd like you to start by doing is putting a base colour on. I'd advise that you start with a pale colour rather than a dark colour, because you'll be adding more colour later on. And your design should include a bird and a leaf motif. Put your template against the side of the pot and start to draw those in.
There's no room for error.
No, you've got one go at this. So you keep going until your surface is divided up and then draw in other features, different shapes. And thereafter, I would start to paint in the key features. Just fill in the inner space when you're adding some colour within the lines. This needs to be really precise. I'm looking for a really great division of the space and the marks within those spaces to be different across the whole surface, and then a really lovely contrasting colour effect.
So not much then?
It's not a lot to achieve.
That's fantastic, Jackie. Thank you very, very much.
You're welcome.
Potters, back to your benches. Okay, well, this is going to be judged blind, so I'm going to ask you three to hop it. Out you go, Jackie.
Okay.
Make my cup of tea. You know how I like it. Potters, you have an hour and a quarter.
Yay.
And your time starts now.
Glad it's not throwdown again.
Oh, I like this.
Before the potters can take flight with their bird and leaf designs,
I thought I'd start with getting the slip on.
They need to add a base layer.
I've mixed a lilac colour. I was going for like a bit more of a dusk sort of background.
She said light. I've done both sides in case I mess one up.
Do you remember anything Jackie said about the base colour she'd start with?
Has everyone gone a bit lighter?
A little bit lighter, yeah, than the grey, yeah.
Oh, can I get another pot?
No. 3 minutes ago. We gave this to you 3 minutes ago.
Right, I'm going in for the first marks.
Templates made. The potters must now scribe their motifs onto the vase.
Oh, you got this a remnant from your main make.
Yeah, something I've been practicing drawing, you know, so it made it a little quicker for me to decide. And
well, it's a beautiful looking owl.
This is my heron. It's a lot more delicate than I thought it was.
In my element. So I'm doing a robin and some holly leaves.
I've done a robin.
Anyone else doing a robin?
Me.
Me.
Yeah.
What leaf motif are you doing?
I've done a oak tree.
Gorgeous.
Leaf, and then some acorns.
Potters, you're halfway through. Princess, how are you getting on?
I just heard what Sophie said. I think we're doing the same design. So oak leaves and a robin.
From the look of it, she's doing an American style oak and you're doing a more of a European style oak. For you.
Now they've made their marks, it's time to add some more colour.
I'm just gonna go straight in with the bird because I feel like that's the most important part.
I'm gonna make the owl whitish.
How do you think the orange is going to get on over the grey?
We're going to find out now, actually.
All right, hold on. I need to warm up before I say I told you so.
Okay. Okay, you ready?
Wow.
Look at that. It might need a few layers.
I'm trying to fill in some big areas.
Trying to create a wee bit of tonal variation. The biggest problem is I like to do a tidy job and we haven't got time for that.
Potters, you've 10 minutes left.
It'd be nice to have another half hour or so.
It's quite nice. Quite like it. Quite sweet. Now it's got an eyeball. Now it looks like an actual bird.
I've gone with red just to... Oh, it looks awful.
Just to ruin it. 5 minutes left, Potters.
5 minutes to do something different.
I suppose you just got to be quite daring with the marks, that you can't overthink them too much, which is quite difficult for me because I tend to overthink.
I'm fairly pleased with where we got to here, but, you know, I could do loads more.
Now I need to stand it up without destroying it. Oh, it looks quite nice standing up.
Does anyone have any black?
Black, ten, yes, I've got black.
9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, tools down. Please bring your vases up to your wear board.
There you go. Oh, nice.
It's getting dropping.
Jackie will now judge the potter's work.
This is the exciting bit.
Yes.
She's looking for striking bird and leaf motifs, combined with a variety of mark-making sections, and finished off with a contrasting colour effect.
Going to start at this end. Well, that's really interesting. I like the bird on this one.
What do you think about the line work, Jackie?
Could have just moved in a few different directions. This person's put the colour all over, but I think I would have liked to have seen a few more marks in there as well as the colour.
OK, next one.
I like the bird. It's a robin, I take it. And an oak leaf. Yes, that's lovely. Well done. Number four.
Wow.
Oh, it's lovely to have a flying bird. It's never occurred to me to put a flying bird into my own surface, so that's an idea to take away with me, isn't it?
Excellent. Number yeah. five.
So exciting.
Like Christmas.
It is like Christmas.
Oh. Wow.
That's a really nice idea, actually, to have a theme going on the surface. Let's have a look at this one. That's
very
beautiful.
Nice, strong line.
Yeah, somebody's used a ruler well there.
Okay, next one.
Ooh. Ooh.
People like robins,
wow.
don't they?
Wow, like the oak leaf. Really?
I like the shape of this robin, though. I like its yeah. simplicity.
Okay.
Ooh.
Ooh, that's very interesting.
Wow.
It's a painting almost.
Yeah.
The lines just add something else to that because you get the sense of water moving.
Last but not least.
Wow, that really sort of shouts at you, doesn't
it? It does, doesn't it?
The colours are wonderful, and I like the way the leaf has been repeated across the surface of it.
Yeah.
It's really, really wonderful.
Wow.
The judges will now rank the potters from worst to first.
They do look like you've enjoyed yourselves. Well done. In ninth place is this one.
Dan.
I think I would have liked to have just seen a few more marks and the space to have been filled a little more. In eighth place is this one.
Ah, Daniel.
I liked your use of colour in terms of the leaves and the backdrop, but I think I'd have liked to have seen a little bit more colour overall.
In seventh place is Stephen. Sixth is Princess. Jan comes fifth. Dave fourth. And it's Sophie in third.
In second place, we have the flying bird.
Donna.
Well done. Beautiful, lovely idea. And you've also put in a really nice range of marks into that, so that's fantastic. And in first place, we have this one. Katie, well done. I love the use of colour in this. I like the fact that you've repeated your leaf shapes, which really balances it out beautifully. So well done.
Congratulations. Time for you to rest. We'll see you later. Potter dismissed.
First in the spot test.
Terrible design. It puts a lot of pressure on the outcome of my goat. Really got to work, otherwise I'm in trouble. No.
The Potter's animal busts have been bisque fired and are ready for decoration. But they'll only find out if their wee beasties have survived intact when they remove the Hessian.
Welcome back, Potters. Your animal busts have been bisque-fired and are ready to be decorated. Judges, any advice?
Make sure you have a really clear plan for your decoration. Think about which bits you want colour and crackle effect on and which bits you're going to leave unglazed. Anything you leave unglazed is likely to go really dark during the raku firing process. So consider how you can integrate that into your animal busts.
Think about how those glazes and oxides work with those surfaces and textures you've created. This is your chance for those animals to really come to life.
OK, Potters, you've been given 2.5 hours to decorate your animal busts, and your time starts now.
Survived!
Hello, gorgeous.
It's looking really well. My jigsaw puzzling of the bust worked. No cracks where I joined them.
No cracks, it's all in one piece. Oh, so yeah, I'm really relieved.
There's a bit of a crack in the wing.
But Daniel's owl hasn't been quite so fortunate.
But it doesn't look like it's going to pop off.
Yeah, because I was a bit concerned when you were putting like a big sheet on.
Yeah.
I was worried that that whole sheet might delaminate. Fingers crossed it'll kind of stay there and not split anymore during the firing.
Yeah, I'm hoping so.
Excited to get decorated now. Tarter up a bit. Oh, him, Gary.
Before they apply any colour, the potters must decide which, if any, areas they will leave unglazed. If the raku is successful, these should turn a dark colour.
Anywhere you wax resist for Raku will stay black.
But that does require a certain amount of mental gymnastics.
It's quite difficult working with this because you're kind of working in reverse. You're putting the areas white that are going to be black and the areas that you want white, you're putting the glaze on.
Not only that, the results from Raku can be completely unpredictable.
I'm relying quite a lot on it being raw on the black sections, which is quite a lot of it. The Raku's going to do most of it.
And it can also place a lot of stress on the clay.
You did cut it in half, didn't you?
I did, yeah. So, yeah, I gave it a good thick coil right. So it was joined in the centre and then kind of smoothed it on the inside.
Yeah.
So there's no sign of a crack there, but, you know, pretty happy with
fingers
it.
Fingers crossed.
Yeah, fingers crossed.
Yeah, it should be all right.
Just like Stephen, Donna will be relying a lot on the Raku for her goat's monochrome colouring.
I'm going to be using quite a lot of wax resist. That should mask off the areas that I want to go dark.
Oh, my God, put the glasses on him. Oh, look! The librarian goat.
But whilst Gary the goat might still be looking a bit pale...
I'm ramping up the colours a bit.
Dave is going all out with the underglazes.
Choosing a turkey, I think it's got a lot of advantages. The colouring is stunning, particularly the male turkeys with the reds and the pale blue contrast. There's no other farm animal really that fits the bill with that.
Potters, that's 1 hour gone.
Along with underglazes...
Was it good pink?
The potters have been given a selection of oxides.
I am oxiding the horns. I want to get them a fun metallic-y look.
I've applied one layer of iron oxide and then I've wiped back because I didn't want it to go too dark.
Say hello to Al. Isn't he gorgeous?
He is gorgeous.
Well, now I've put on this red iron oxide. Now I'm taking off the surface.
So it'll give it a bit more of a texture.
Well, yeah, it's to give it, like, a depth. It's in the mess I'm making on the floor. Dripping off my elbow.
OK, I'm going to help you here now. I could show you what they do to me when I have my lunch.
Bit of a mucky papa.
Completely.
Just like me.
Yes, yes, absolutely, absolutely. But sure, life's too short
life's
to be
too
tidy.
Short.
Unlike underglazes, which remained fairly true to form, oxides can be unpredictable.
The thing is with the oxides, they don't turn out what they look like now.
If the potters handled the Raku firing well, they should transform.
I've been using a mixture of manganese dioxide and red iron oxide. I'm hoping I'll get different shades of reddish brown.
I'm going to go with copper oxide, which is the really strong one. That should go properly bronze. I have used it before, and it did come out green.
On the horns, it's quite concentrated copper. It will give it a bit of shine. And I might have snuck a little bit on the forehead, which might be a mistake.
Half an hour left, potters, half an hour left.
Putting on the crackle glaze. Just on the head and neck, I want it to be shiny and crackled.
The potters have also been given both white and transparent crackle glazes to make the most of the Raku firing.
The thermal shock, when you take it out of the kiln, it makes the glaze crack. Like an old piece of pottery, really.
So I'm going to do the white crackle on the nose, round the eyes and in the ears, and then transparent where I've done all the underglaze, so hopefully that'll protect the colour.
I'm really looking forward to getting it in the kiln, yeah, seeing the finished thing.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, turkey.
What?
No, it's gobble gobble, isn't it?
Yeah, I know, I couldn't do that while doing a ventriloquist act now.
The feathers you've given her, absolutely beautiful.
It's a hen.
Oh, I beg your pardon.
Because it's got caruncles and all the display equipment.
That's for display.
It is for display. It's amazing what female turkeys find attractive,
isn't it? Amazing.
I'm looking forward to seeing what happens. Roll on the firing, really.
Raku day. I've been waking up every hour since 2 a.m. thinking, is it time to get up? Is it time to get up yet?
Fire day. I did sleep, but I slept with a fiery dream.
Anything can happen today. It's going to be a lot of fire. It's going to be a lot of smoke. Things are going to smell really weird.
How excited are you on a scale of 1 to 10?
10, 11, 12. It's going to be absolutely great.
You're all nervous. Well, as you can see, the Raku kilns are ready for you to load with your animal busts and fire up. We have a master potter, Kevin, here to make sure that we don't die. Judges, any last minute advice for our very nervous looking potters?
Right, really take care with those tongs. Steady hands, steady nerves. Look, what I'm really trying to say is don't drop them. all right?
You are in charge of your firings. You decide when your animals come out of the kiln and how long they stay in the reduction box. Make sure you've got a clear plan and that you stick to it.
All right, then. We're going to start with Katie, Princess and Dave. Don the safety gear.
Raku is one of the most unpredictable procedures in ceramics.
This is going to keep us warm as well, right?
So the potters will work in tightly controlled groups and take every care against the superhuman heat.
Raku man! Crackles wherever he goes.
Raku, I'm excited for this.
Dave's first into the hotspot.
Oh, he's turkey.
He's a weird shape.
All right, here we go. Be careful.
Whoa.
Their bisque-fired busts are extremely vulnerable. One wrong move transporting them to and from the Raku kiln could spell disaster.
Ooh.
Come on, birdie. Oh, in she
oh,
goes.
Well done, well done.
See you on the other side. Any more word for the fox?
Just don't break.
This is the last look.
Go on, good luck.
Excellent.
Light the kiln. Raku kilns can reach temperatures in excess of 1,000 degrees centigrade in just 20 minutes.
So what's the temperature right now?
60 degrees.
That's right, we've got a little way to go.
When they take their animals out, we'll be entirely down to the potters.
Keep an eye on the gloss of the glazes.
Are you ready to take a look?
Yeah.
Ultimately, their decision must rest on visual cues rather than temperature.
No, not ready yet.
It's meant to look like the surface is honey-like.
Kevin, do you mind if I have a quick check?
Yep, yep.
The glazes and oxides react with the heat.
Oh, not far.
If they take them out too soon, they won't achieve their desired effect.
No, it's still all white. It's like a slightly badly iced bun.
Oh, right, yeah.
Not honey.
But if they leave them in too long, they could explode.
I'm sort of becoming more comfortable with the unknown because I have to be.
If it's honey-like, it's coming out.
OK, please can I have a peep? Oh, yes. I think it's ready.
You think it's ready? Off we go, then.
I'm going in.
OK, let's do it. I'm ready.
Get that turkey out of the oven.
Oh, that is hot.
Oh, she's beautiful!
Deep breath.
Yeah. Oh, no, she's got a crack.
Uh-oh. Uh-oh.
There's a crack. Quite a big one in the front. Did you see it?
Right at the back.
No, right in the front.
There's one at the back.
Are you joking?
No.
Oh, no. Oh, God.
Oh, wow!
Oh, my God, it's still in one piece. Amazing. Woo!
It's only when their molten hot busts are plunged into a reduction box with combustibles that the real magic of Raku occurs.
My combustibles? Last year's Christmas tree.
Turkey, Christmas, like it.
We're on a theme. Should have put a robin in there and all.
I've got some seaweed, so fingers crossed, help with the tones that I'm really keen to get.
As the box lid is shut, the chamber is starved of oxygen.
Okay.
Creating a reductive atmosphere, and unglazed areas will carbonize and go black.
Done. So we've got two cracks. If they'd come out glossy and shiny. So I'm happy about that.
So few cracks are appearing. It's difficult because if there's even the slightest fault, this will exacerbate the problem.
Yeah, Raku is a really, really violent process.
It is.
Let's do it.
And having joined his cow down the middle, Stephen has more to worry about than most.
Good luck, dummy. Godspeed. Lonely. Lonely and scared, but God, I really hope she stays in one piece.
It's ridiculous how attached you get to these pieces of clay.
All right, you got your sacrifice for the kiln god?
Yeah. Gary's going by the neck. Exciting.
All right, Al, off we go.
Be good boy now.
Bye, Al. Are you nervous?
Terrified. What if he ends up in bits?
He won't.
OK, let's have a look at Gary. I'm going to hold off just another little bit longer, trying desperately to hold my nerve.
Ready to have a little look?
Yeah. Oh, oh no. Big crack down the middle, where the join was. Oh, well.
I just really hope it's intact for him. You know, I hope that crack hasn't completely blown it apart.
Ooh. Go on, Jan.
That's great.
All right, you ready, Donna?
Yep, let's do this. Oh, excited, I'm excited.
The cooling atmosphere and lack of oxygen in the reduction box...
I brought a load of alpaca hair. It's going to stink.
...encourages the all-important crackle glaze. And oxides like copper take on a metallic luster.
It's not a great smell, is it?
Maybe the hair wasn't such a good choice.
Oh, it's a big crack.
Oh, nice.
Despite the crack down the middle, Demi Moore seems to be holding it together, but she's not out of the danger zone yet.
It stayed in one piece, but I think the cool down is the bit that's going to put it under more tension, so I can only hope and pray.
All right, happy?
Good girl.
So, last into the Raku kiln, Daniel's owl.
Bye.
Sophie's donkey.
Goodbye, Nita. Survive, please.
And Dan's goat.
Excited. Nervous, very nervous. All the cracks so far, yeah.
You feeling nervous?
I feel okay.
Okay. Yeah. Really tense. I'm so scared.
Ah! It's all right, isn't it?
Yeah.
Ready, Daniel?
Ready.
Got a bit of a
crack coming up.
Ah! That's shinier than I thought.
Well done.
Right. Right over the top.
Yeah, get it on those horns.
Oh, I think that's okay, yeah. It looks glossy and shiny, so yeah, it's done.
Are you happy?
Had a few cracks on the back of the head and up the wing, but yeah, we'll see how it looks when I get scrubbed up.
Ooh, it's like buried treasure.
After the intense firing process.
Oh, the smell of the hair.
And having allowed enough time for the Raku alchemy to take place, it's the moment of truth.
Nice.
Oh, my God.
Oh, metallics look good.
Oh.
Looks good. All in one piece. Yeah. It's really hot.
Yeah, I'm happy. At the minute, he's still in one piece.
This is our alpaca. Look at the metallic sheen.
It's amazing, isn't it?
He looks really sexy, to be honest. The sexiest alpaca bust I've ever made.
Wow, that's quite something, that is.
Are you delighted?
It's come out all right, isn't it? Just stay together. Stay together. Don't you crack.
Oh, yeah, no, it is a crack at the back.
Oh! The crack at the back, I think, is where the cylinder joints were.
Definitely not good.
You can kind of see that crack opening up there. I got a bit on the back of the head as well. I think it's where I've attached those wings.
Yeah, I think my nightmare's been realised.
It's in two.
Exactly where the join was.
Well, look. You've got some really nice reactions there.
Yeah.
All is not lost.
Right, I'm going to start washing it and then, yeah, see it all come to life.
It's only by delicately cleaning their animal busts.
Look how nice the white has come out. Oh, my God, that's so exciting.
The potters will discover whether the glazes and textures they painstakingly applied have worked.
Oh, look at his nose.
Yeah, nice.
Yeah.
Relief. It has got an arresting stare. That's the best looking turkey I've seen. Your caruncles are looking magnificent, sir.
But not all the potters are so thrilled.
I'm hoping I can glue it.
I put copper carbonate down the middle. I was trying to get sort of browny colour of hair, but it looks more like mould or moss or something.
And Daniel has even bigger problems.
I scrubbed a bit off and it split down the back. So, yeah, got half an hour now.
It's a bit gutting, but what can you do? It's Raku.
It's judgment time for the potter's Raku-fired farmyard animal busts.
Donna, would you please bring your animal bust up to the judges?
It looks like a goat, Donna. Well done.
Thank you.
I like the fact the white crackle glaze has really worked. And the texture that you've managed to get into those horns, brilliant.
Yeah, the horns are wonderful.
Thank
they
you.
Really are. Overall, your use of texture and the glazes and the colour and the carbonisation of the raku is really on point. And, yeah, really well made.
And a really good observation of those eyes. They do have those kind of letterbox eyes. Overall, it's a wonderful piece and you should be really proud of it. Yeah, it's
great.
Thank
you. Thanks.
The first impression is that it looks like your animal. So, job done. The second thing, for someone who's completely glazed it all over, you have managed to get the differentiation between the different parts of the face. The texture of the hair blending into the nose looks fantastic.
The quality of the build overall, I'd say, is really, really outstanding. It's a really great example of a white crackle glaze in raku. You know, you've got a really healthy reduction on it.
How do you feel about it?
Oh, I love him. I think he's awesome.
Thank you very much.
Your observation of the ears and the nose really help you because the neck is a bit on the stiff side.
Okay.
And I know you had a few problems with the construction. Having that cylinder and the head separate probably worked against you.
Yeah.
But the colour is brilliant. It really, really works.
Overall, I would say, yeah, the fur is incredible. And the level of detail you've built into it is really quite beautiful. It's a shame that there's been a few issues with that cracking because overall, I think the tone and the colour and the observation with the surfaces are really, really quite stunning.
What I love about it, there's a sort of a comical element to it, but actually it's realistic, which is what we were looking for. I love the way you've been able to get that energy in the ears.
I just think it's a lovely example of the way you can use the contrasting colours of raku. You've got this very white, crackly nose. It comes together really well as a sort of an overall concept.
It's great. Well done, Sophie.
Yeah, really
well
done.
Thank you very much.
The face looks fantastic, but obviously one can't ignore the huge cracks in it. When you were constructing it, you were manipulating that surface quite a lot. You're trying to press mold those plaster molds into it.
Yes, I was deforming it a little bit, and so I ended up using separate slabs and attaching those. I think that might have contributed a bit too.
I mean, my goodness, though, the crackle
is amazing.
Of that glaze is out of this world. It's just got such a lovely quality to it. You gave yourself a really tough challenge picking this particular owl because there isn't a lot of colour. But I think overall, the surface is really quite beautiful.
Thank you.
When I came round to see your workbench, I was a bit worried, I must admit.
Yeah.
You know, there wasn't much form there to really sort of define the features. But Katie, really, this is a wonderful example of how the decoration can really enhance the form. It's bloody brilliant.
Thank you.
It's really, really nice. The eyes are fantastic, and the fact that you've got this white crackle glaze on here to define that beak from the head has really worked.
Yeah, thank you.
The decoration is really quite exquisite. The way you've used that wax resist to really demonstrate the kind of contrast you can get using the raku process, I think you've done really well.
Thank you.
The first thing that strikes me is the overall structure. It works really, really well. These are wonderful. The fact that you've left them unglazed, really lovely. And that crackle is great. What have you used on here, the copper?
Yeah, it's copper and iron.
Why did you do that?
What I was trying to get is like this sort of like hair coming over the top.
It's difficult, isn't it? Because copper, actually, if it had had a really heavy reduction, it's quite likely some of that copper would have reduced more and you would have got
red.
Copper more than
yeah.
green. But
yeah.
I think on the whole, there's lots of really lovely raku surfaces in this. The crackle glaze has worked really, really well. It's got a bit of character about it.
I actually really like it, apart from the copper.
Yeah.
Well, on first reflection, it's colourful, It's very formidable. And the sheer scale of the construction and the fact that the snood has stayed on there and all your attributes have stayed on is a testament to your making and the way that you handled it in the whole Raku process. Brilliant. I'm loving the texture that you've managed to get on here. It would have been nice to see a bit more lustrous kind of reaction on these feathers, but I can't fault the construction. It's brilliant.
Yeah, my goodness, Dave. Yeah. You've just managed to create something with such character. And the fact that that's gone to 1,000 degrees and been whipped out of the kiln and it's all still in one piece, all credit to you. Really, really wonderful.
Well, I love your cow. It's got real character. That tongue is just brilliant. The use of the glaze works really, really well.
There is a scarily surgical line down the middle. It was always going to be tricky dismantling those two halves and then reassembling them because Raku is so aggressive. But aside from that, Demi is so well observed. I mean, she is really staggeringly beautiful.
She is beautiful.
She is. Such character. You've created that kind of sinew and muscles. It's just got so many endearing qualities.
You should be really, really proud of it. The fact that it pulled away in that firing process, that still doesn't take away the enjoyment of actually making it.
No, it doesn't. It's just, it's heart-wrenching when you spent so much time over something and then it, you know, you see it until you break into yourself, you know.
But that's the wonder and the value of ceramics because you do put your heart and soul into it.
Yeah.
Absolutely wonderful.
Thank you. I really liked it. It's just the cracks. But that's a game changer, whether it's going to be fatal or not, I don't know.
Everything went to plan pretty much. I don't think I could have made it any better. Nothing fell off and the shiny bits were shiny.
I feel like I could be going this week, to be honest. But I did enjoy making the bus.
Maybe I might still get through, but I think if I was going to pick something at home, it's probably me.
Another year, another Raku week. Who do you think did really well?
For me, Katie.
Yeah, she's just taken what is a very, very simple form and used the transformative nature of Raku to create something that had rich depth and tone.
Is she in line for Potter of the Week?
I think she could be.
Really? Who else?
Well, Dave has to be a potential. Yeah. I mean, the quality of his sculpting.
Yeah, there were so many things that could have gone wrong. His snood stayed on, and that attention to detail with the surface texture was really wonderful.
Who else?
Possibly Sophie, but for very different reasons.
Oh, yeah?
Sophie's was a fine example of the Raku process and the kind of richness you can obtain from the glazes.
And we must talk about Demi Moore.
Yeah, it was brilliant, but it did split in
half. It did split in half.
I really believe if it hadn't split in half, we'd be talking about him
as
being
Potter
in line for Potter of the Week.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
No, absolutely. Ooh. Yeah, yeah.
But someone has to go.
Well, Daniel has to be considered. We saw a lot of cracking, lot of cracking.
Yeah, and Princess, possibly.
Okay, well, I don't envy you making those decisions, but let's not keep them waiting till the cows come home. Well done, Potters, on another wonderful week. The judges have come to their decision. Firstly, the nice bit. This week's Potter of the Week. Congratulations, Dave. Your turkey done good, eh?
Gobble.
Brilliant, well done. Now the less nice bit. The potter who will be leaving the pottery this week is Daniel.
Daniel, it's all right. It's all right. You know, I kind of mentally prepared myself. I was pretty sure it was going to be me this week.
I'm going to be sorry to
see you go. Like, I had a really enjoyable time here. I've learned a lot from the other potters, and yeah, it's been a good time.
You're still a great potter. Really, really good.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. It's bittersweet, because on one end, I'm really happy to continue the journey, but I'm also really sad to see Daniel go.
It's been such a privilege, you know. I've learned so much from all of you.
God, yeah. So sad.
Another member of the family's leaving, and it hurts every week.
Dave, well done, well done.
Yay, well done.
Worked out pretty well, didn't it, really?
Really good, mate. Really pleased for you, yeah.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, yeah. The level of the achievement, for me, it's really significant because these people are really good potters, and to be holding my own in that company is smashing. It really is. I feel great.
As Daniel leaves the pottery, Dave's turkey takes the fourth spot in the throwdown gallery. Next time.
Dear God.
The biggest build so far.
Balances like that look. Ooh, I've done it right.
Cascading bowls, water features.
Quietly having a word with myself here.
And a hedgehog house and garden week.
Please don't collapse.
Who will keep their head above water?
Some major faults in the build.
And who will be in floods?
Needs somebody to turn this on.
If only. Jan.